You are listening to a Clarkesworld Magazine podcast. I'm your host, Kate Baker. Your narrator is Alethea Kontis. 26 Monkeys, Also the Abyss, by Kij Johnson. This story is our second to last story for the month of March, 2019. Issue 150. Now, our author, Kij Johnson, is the author of several novels, including The Fox Woman and Fudoki, and a short story collection, At the Mouth of the River of Bees. She's a three-time winner of the Nebula Award and has also won the Hugo, World Fantasy, Sturgeon, and the Crawford Awards. In the past, she has worked in publishing, edited cryptic crosswords, waitressed in a strip bar, identified Napa Cabernets by winery and year while blindfolded, and climbed an occasional V5. These days, she teaches at the University of Kansas, where she is Associate Director for the Center for the Study of Science Fiction. Kij can be found at her website, kijjohnson.com. Now, our narrator, Alethea Kontis, is doing me a huge favor. As I mentioned on the previous podcast, my father passed away recently, and Alethea graciously stepped in to help narrate some of these podcasts at the end of the month. So thank you, Alethea. You are amazing. Now, for those of you who may not know Alethea, Alethea Kontis is a princess, fairy godmother, and geek, host of Princess Alethea's Fairy Tale Rants and Princess Alethea's Traveling Sideshow every year at Dragon Con. Alethea has also narrated for ACX, IGMS, Escape Pod, Pseudopod, Cast of Wonders, and Clarkesworld. She contributes regular YA book reviews to NPR, and Alethea currently resides on the space coast of Florida with her teddy bear, Charlie. You can find out more about Alethea at patreon.com/princessalethea. So, my dear listener, I do hope you can sit back, relax, and let Alethea tell you a story.
1. Amy's big trick is that she makes 26 monkeys vanish on stage. 2. She pushes out a clawfoot bathtub and asks audience members to come up and inspect it. The people climb in and look underneath, touch the white enamel, run their hands along the little lion's feet. When they're done, four chains are lowered from the proscenium stage's fly space. Amy secures them to holes drilled along the tub's lip, gives a signal, and the bathtub is hoisted 10 feet into the air. She sets a stepladder next to it. She claps her hands and the 26 monkeys on stage run up the ladder one after the other and jump into the bathtub. The bathtub shakes as each monkey thuds in among the others. The audience can see heads, legs, tails, but eventually every monkey settles in and the bathtub is still again. Zeb is always the last monkey up the ladder. As he climbs into the bathtub, he makes a humming boom deep in his chest. It fills the stage. And then there's a flash of light. Two of the chains fall off, and the bathtub swings down to expose its interior. Empty. 3. They turn up later, back at the tour bus. There's a smallish dog door, and in the hours before morning, the monkeys let themselves in, alone or in small groups, and get themselves glasses of water from the tap. If more than one returns at the same time, they murmur a bit among themselves, like college students meeting in the dorm halls after bar time. A few sleep on the sofa, and at least one likes to be on the bed, but most of them wander back to their cages. There's a little grunting as they rearrange their blankets and soft toys, and then sighs and snoring. Amy doesn't really sleep until she hears them all come in. Amy has no idea what happens to them in the bathtub, or where they go, or what they do before the soft click of the dog door opening. This bothers her a lot. 4. Amy has had the act for 3 years now. She was living in a month-by-month furnished apartment under a flight path for the Salt Lake City Airport. She was hollow, as if something had chewed a hole in her body and the hole had grown infected.
There was a monkey act at the Utah State Fair.
She felt a sudden and totally out-of-character urge to see it. And afterward, with no idea why, she walked up to the owner and said, "I have to buy this." He nodded. He sold it to her for $1, which he told her was the price he had paid 4 years before. Later, when the paperwork was filled out, she asked him, "How can you leave them? Won't they miss you?"
"You'll see. They're pretty autonomous," he said. "Yeah, they'll miss me, and I'll miss them. But it's time. They know that."
He smiled at his new wife, a small woman with laugh lines and a vervet hanging from one hand.
"We're ready to have a garden," she said.
He was right. The monkeys missed him. But they also welcomed her, each monkey politely shaking her hand as she walked into what was now her bus.
5. Amy has a 19-year-old tour bus packed with cages that range in size from parrot-sized,
for the vervets,
to something about the size of a pickup bed, for all the macaques. A stack of books on monkeys ranging from All About Monkeys to Evolution and Ecology of Baboon Societies. Some sequin show costumes, a sewing machine, and a bunch of Carhartts and tees. A stack of show posters from the few years back that say, 24 monkeys face the abyss. A battered sofa in a virulent green plaid. And a boyfriend who helps with the monkeys. She cannot tell you why she has any of these. Not even the boyfriend, whose name is Jeff, whom she met in Billing 7 months ago. Amy has no idea where anything comes from anymore. She no longer believes that anything makes sense, even though she can't stop hoping. The bus smells about as you'd expect a bus full of monkeys to smell. Though after a show, after the bathtub trick, but before the monkeys all return, it also smells of cinnamon, which is the tea Amy sometimes drinks.
6.
For the act, the monkeys do tricks, or dress up in outfits and act out hit movies. The Matrix is very popular, as is anything where the monkeys dress up like little orcs. The maned monkeys, the lion tails and the colobuses, have a lion tamer act, with the old Capuchin female, Pango, dressed in a red jacket and carrying a whip in a small chair. The chimpanzee, whose name is Mimi, and no, she is not a monkey, can do actual sleight of hand. She's not very good, but she's the best chimp pulling a coin from someone's ear in the world. The monkeys can also build a suspension bridge out of wood chairs and rope, make a 4-tier champagne fountain, and write their names on a whiteboard. With a schedule of 127 shows this year at fairs and festivals across the Midwest and Great Plains, Amy could do more, but she likes to let everyone have a couple of months off at Christmas. 7. This is the bathtub act. Amy wears a glittering purple-black dress designed to look like a scanty magician's robe. She stands in front of a scrim lit deep blue and scattered with stars. The monkeys are ranged in front of her. As she speaks, they undress and fold their clothes into neat piles. Zeb sits on his stool to one side, a white spotlight shining straight down to give him a shadowed look. She raises her hands. "These monkeys have made you laugh and made you gasp. They have created wonders for you and performed mysteries. But there is a final mystery they offer you, the strangest, the greatest of all." She parts her hands suddenly, and the scrim goes transparent and is lifted away, revealing the bathtub on a raised dais. She walks around it, running her hand along the tub's curves. "It's a simple thing, this bathtub. Ordinary in every way, mundane as breakfast. In a moment, I will invite members of the audience up to let you prove this for yourselves. But for the monkeys, it is also a magical object. It allows them to travel. No one can say where. Not even I." She pauses.
can tell you this. Only the monkeys know, and they share no secrets. Where do they go? Into heaven, foreign lands, other worlds, or some dark abyss? We cannot follow. They will vanish before our eyes, vanish from this most ordinary of things. And after the bathtub is inspected and she has told the audience that there will be no final spectacle in the show, it will be hours before they return from their secret travels. And called for applause for them, she gives the cue. 8. Amy's Monkeys.
Two Siamangs, a mated couple.
Two squirrel monkeys, though they're so active they might as well be twice as many.
Two vervets. A Gwenin,
who is probably pregnant, though it's still too early to tell for sure. Amy has no idea how this happened. 3 rhesus monkeys. They juggle a little.
An older Capuchin female named Pango.
A crested macaque. 3 snow monkeys, one quite young. And a Java macaque. Despite the differences, they have formed a small troop and like to sleep together. A chimpanzee, who is not actually a monkey.
A surly gibbon.
2 marmosets. A golden tamarin, a cotton-top tamarin. A proboscis monkey. Red and black colobuses. Zeb. 9.
Amy thinks Zeb might be a Debrazis Gwenin,
except that he's so old that he has lost almost all his hair. She worries about his health, but he insists on staying in the act. By now, all he's really up for is the final rush to the bathtub, and for him, it is more of a stroll. The rest of the time, he sits on a stool that is painted orange and silver and watches the other monkeys, looking like an aging impresario watching his swan lake from the wings. Sometimes she gives him things to hold, such as a silver hoop through which the squirrel monkeys jump. 10. No one knows how the monkeys vanish or where they go. Sometimes they return holding foreign coins or durian fruit, or wearing pointed Moroccan slippers. Every so often, one returns pregnant. The number of monkeys is not constant.
I just don't get it, Amy keeps asking Jeff, as if he has any idea.
Amy never knows anything anymore. She's been living without any certainties. And this one thing, well, the whole thing, the fact the monkeys get along so well and know how to do card tricks and just turned up in her life and vanished from the bathtub, everything. She coasts with that most of the time, but every so often, when she feels her life is wheeling without brakes down a long hill, she starts poking at this again. Jeff trusts the universe a lot more than Amy does, trusts that things make sense and that people can love, and therefore he doesn't need the same proofs.
You could just ask them, he says.
11. Amy's boyfriend. Jeff is not at all what Amy expected from a boyfriend. For one thing, he's 15 years younger than Amy, 28 to her 43. For another, he's sort of quiet. For a third, he's gorgeous, silky, thick hair pulled into a shoulder-length ponytail, shaved sides showing off his strong jawline. He smiles a lot, but he doesn't laugh very often. Jeff has a degree in history, which means that he was working in a bike repair shop when she met him at the Montana Fair. Amy never has much to do right after the show, so when he offered to buy her a beer, she said yes. And then it was 4 a.m., and they were kissing in the bus, monkeys letting themselves in and getting ready for bed. And Amy and Jeff made love. In the morning, over breakfast, the monkeys came up one by one and shook his hand solemnly. And then he was with the band, so to speak. She helped him pick up his cameras and clothes and the surfboard his sister had painted for him one year as a Christmas present. There's no room for the surfboard, so it's suspended from the ceiling. Sometimes the squirrel monkeys hang out there and peek over the side. Amy and Jeff never talk about love.
Jeff has a Class C driver's license, but this is just Lanyap. 12. Zeb is dying. Generally speaking, the monkeys are remarkably healthy and Amy can handle their occasional sinus infections and gastrointestinal ailments. For anything more difficult, she's found a couple of communities online and some helpful specialists. But Zeb's coughing some, and the last of his fur is falling out. He moves very slowly and sometimes has trouble remembering simple tasks. When the show was up in St. Paul 6 months ago, a Como zoo biologist came to visit the monkeys, complimented her on their general health and well-being, and at her request looked Zeb over.
"How old is he?"
the biologist, Gina, asked.
"I don't know," Amy said. The man she bought the show from hadn't known either.
"I'll tell you then," Gina said. "He's old. I mean seriously old.
Senile dementia, arthritis, a heart murmur. No telling when," Gina said.
"He's a happy monkey," she said. "He'll go when he goes."
13. Amy thinks a lot about this. What happens to the act when Zeb's dead? Through each show, he sits calm and poised on his bright stool. She feels he is somehow at the heart of the monkey's amiability and cleverness. She keeps thinking that he is somehow the reason the monkeys all vanish and return. Because there's always a reason for everything. Isn't there? Because if there isn't a reason for even one thing, like how you can get sick or your husband stopped loving you, or people you love die, then there's no reason for anything. So there must be reasons. Zeb's as good a guess as any. 14. What Amy likes about this life. It doesn't mean anything. She doesn't live anywhere. Her world is 38 feet and 127 shows long and currently 26 monkeys deep. This is manageable. Fares don't mean anything either. Her tiny world travels within a slightly larger world, the identical, interchangeable fares. Sometimes the only things that cue Amy to the town she's in are the nighttime temperatures and the shape of the horizon, badlands, mountains, plains, or skyline. Fares are as artificial as titanium knees. The carnival, the animal barns, the stock car races, the concerts, the smell of burned sugar and funnel cakes and animal bedding. Everything is an overly bright symbol for something real. Food or pets or hanging out with friends. None of this has anything to do with the world Amy used to live in, the world from which these people visit. She has decided that Jeff is like the rest of it. Temporary, meaningless, not for loving. 15. These are some ways Amy's life might have come apart. 1. She might have broken her ankle a few years ago and gotten a bone infection that left her on crutches for 10 months and in pain for longer. 2. Her husband might have fallen in love with his admin and left her. 3. She might have been fired from her job in the same week she found out her sister had colon cancer. 4. She might have gone insane for a time and made a series of questionable choices that left her alone in a furnished apartment in a city she picked out of the Atlas. Nothing is certain. You can lose everything. Eventually, even at your luckiest, you will die, and then you will lose it all. When you are a certain age, or when you have lost certain things and people, Amy's crippling grief will make a terrible, poisoned, dark sense. 16. Amy has read up a lot, so she knows how strange all this is. There aren't any locks on the cages. The monkeys use them as bedrooms, places to store their special possessions, and get away from the others when they want some privacy. Much of the time, however, they are loose in the bus or poking around in the worn grass around it.
Right now, three monkeys are sitting on the bed playing a game where they match colored balls. Others are playing with skeins of bright wool, or rolling around on the floor, or poking at a piece of wood with a screwdriver, or climbing on Amy and Jeff and the battered sofa. Some of the monkeys are crowded around the computer, watching kitten videos on a pirated wireless connection. The black colobus is stacking children's wooden blocks on the kitchenette table. He brought them back one night a couple of weeks ago, and since then he's been trying to make an arch. After 2 weeks, and Amy's showing him repeatedly how a keystone works, he still hasn't figured it out, but he's still patiently trying. Jeff's reading a novel out loud to the Capuchin, Pango, who watches the pages as if she's reading along. Sometimes she points to a word and looks up at him with her bright eyes, and he repeats it to her, smiling, and then spells it out. Zeb is sleeping in his cage. He crept in there at dusk, fluffed up his toys and his blanket, and pulled the door closed behind him. He does this a lot lately. 17. Amy's going to lose Zeb. And then what? What happens to all the other monkeys? 26 monkeys is a lot of monkeys, but they all like each other. No one except maybe a zoo or a circus can keep that many monkeys. And she doesn't think anyone else will let them sleep wherever they like, or watch kitten videos. And if Zeb's not there, where will they go? Those nights when they can no longer drop through the bathtub and into their mystery? And she doesn't even know whether it is Zeb, whether he is the cause of this, or that's just her flailing for reasons again. And Amy? She'll lose her safe artificial world. The bus, the identical fares, the meaningless boyfriend, the monkeys. And then what? 18. Just a few months after she bought the act, when she didn't care much about whether she lived or died, she followed the monkeys up the ladder in the closing act. Zeb raced up the ladder, stepped into the bathtub, and stood, lungs filling for his great call. And she ran up after him. She glimpsed the bathtub's interior, the monkeys tidily sardined in, scrambling to get out of her way as they realized what she was doing. She hopped into the hole they made for her, curled up tight. This only took an instant. Zeb finished his breath, boomed it out. There was a flash of light. She heard the chains release and felt the bathtub swing down, monkeys shifting around her. She fell the 10 feet alone. Her ankle twisted when she hit the stage, but she managed to stay upright. The monkeys were gone. Again. There was an awkward silence. It wasn't one of her more successful performances. 19. Amy and Jeff walk through the midway at the Salina Fair. She's hungry and doesn't want to cook, so they're looking for somewhere that sells $4.50 hot dogs and $3.25 Cokes. And suddenly Jeff turns to Amy and says, "This is bullshit. Why don't we go into town, have real food, act like normal people?" So they do. Pasta and wine at a place called Irina's Villa. "You're always asking why they go," Jeff says, a bottle and a half in. His eyes are an indeterminate blue-gray, but in this light, they look black and very warm. "See, I don't think we're ever going to find out what happens. But I don't think that's the real question anyway. Maybe the question is, why do they come back?" Amy thinks of the foreign coins, the wood blocks, the wonderful things they bring home. "I don't know," she says. "Why do they come back?" Later that night, back at the bus, Jeff says, "Wherever they go, yeah, it's cool. But see, here's my theory." He gestures to the crowded bus with its clutter of toys and tools. The two tamarins have just come in, and they're sitting on the kitchenette counter, heads close as they examine some new small thing. "They're, like, visiting wherever it is, sure, but this is their home. Everyone likes to come home sooner or later."
"If they have a home," Amy says.
"Everyone has a home, even if they don't believe in it," Jeff says.
20. That night, when Jeff's asleep, curled up around one of the macaques, Amy kneels by Zeb's cage.
Can you at least show me? She asks. Please, before you go?
Zeb is an indeterminate lump under his baby blue blanket, but he gives a little sigh and climbs slowly out of his cage. He takes her hand with his own hot, leathery paw, and they walk out the door into the night. The back lot where all the trailers and buses are parked is quiet, only a few voices still audible from behind curtain windows. The sky is blue, black, and scattered with stars. The moon shines straight down on them, leaving Zeb's face shadowed. His eyes, where he looks up, seem bottomless. The bathtub is backstage, already on its wheeled dais waiting for the next show. The space is nearly pitch dark, lit by some red exit signs, and a single sodium vapor away off to one side. Zeb walks her up to the tub, lets her run her hands along its cold curves and the lion's paws, and shows her the dimly lit interior. And then he heaves himself up onto the dais and over the tub lip. She stands beside him looking down. He lifts himself upright and gives his great boom. And then he drops flat, and the bathtub is empty. She saw it, him vanishing. He was there, and then he was gone. But there was nothing to see. No gate, no flickering reality, or soft pop as air snapped in to fill the vacated space. It still doesn't make sense, but it's the answer that Zeb has. He's already back at the bus when she gets there, already buried under his blanket and wheezing in his sleep. 21. Then one day, everyone is backstage. Amy is finishing her makeup and Jeff is double-checking everything. The monkeys are sitting neatly in a circle in the dressing room, as if trying to keep their bright vests and skirts from creasing. Zeb sits in the middle, beside Pango in her little green sequined outfit. They grunt a bit, then lean back. One after the other, the rest of the monkeys crawl forward and shake his hand, and then hers. She nods like a small queen at a flower show. That night, Zeb doesn't run up the ladder. He stays on his stool, and it's Pango who is the last monkey up the ladder, who climbs into the bathtub and gives a screech. Amy has been wrong that it is Zeb who is still the heart of what is happening with the monkeys. But she was so sure of it that she missed all the cues. But Jeff didn't miss a thing. So when Pango screeches, he hits the flash powder. The flash. The empty bathtub. Zeb stands on his stool, bowing like an impresario called on stage for the curtain call. When the curtain drops for the last time, he reaches up to be lifted. Amy cuddles him as they walk back to the bus, Jeff's arm around them both. Zeb falls asleep with them that night, between them in the bed. When she wakes up in the morning, he's back in his cage with his favorite toy. He doesn't wake up. The monkeys cluster at the bars, peeking in. Amy cries all day.
It's okay, Jeff says.
It's not about Zeb,
she sobs.
I know,
he says. 22. Here's the trick to the bathtub trick. There is no trick. The monkeys pour across the stage and up the ladder and into the bathtub, and they settle in, and then they vanish. The world is full of strange things, things that make no sense, and maybe this is one of them. Maybe the monkeys choose not to share. That's cool. Who can blame them? Maybe this is the monkeys' mystery. How they found other monkeys that ask questions and try things, and figured out a way to all be together to share it. Maybe Amy and Jeff are really just house guests in the monkeys' world. They are there for a while, and then they leave. 23. 6 weeks later, a man walks up to Amy, as she and Jeff kiss after a show. He's short, pale, balding. He has the shell-shocked look of a man eaten hollow from the inside.
She knows the look.
I need to buy this, he says.
Amy nods. I know you do. She sells it to him for $1. 24. 3 months later, Amy and Jeff get their first house guest in their apartment in Bellingham. They hear the refrigerator close and come out to the kitchen to find Pango pouring orange juice from a carton. They send her home with a pinnacle deck.
This has been 26 Monkeys, also The Abyss, by author Kij Johnson. Again, my thanks go out to Alethea Kontis for the narration. We have one more story left for you for March 2019, issue 150, so I do hope you can come back and listen. Until then, I bid you a very fond and warm and hopefully very temporary farewell.